Hello everyone and welcome back to another video, and today we are really going to use all the space that we have right here. The camera is really really high up, so if I bump the table it might vibrate a lot. So what we are looking at today is first of all a giant box. This is the box that my RTX 2080 Ti came in. And yeah, the reason why I'm showing the box, because this is actually not the thing I want to show off. It's just, it is huge. Like pretty much every reviewer of who made a review of this card also mentioned how big this box is. And yeah, it's big. And that's pretty much it. What we're actually looking at today is what's in it. And that's not the card. The card is already in my system. But we're going to look at the heatsink that we sort of see here. So let me just take that out. Ah, there we have it. Yeah, we get another box. And in that box we find well, documentation. And then under that, we would have the card, but only the heatsink now, because, well, my card is already water-cooled. Then another nice thing that they actually include is this kinda, yeah, this graphics card stand. So if you get a lot of GPU sag, you can use this to balance your graphics card. Obviously, I have it in a vertical mount, so I don't need that, but for anyone who is not using a vertical mount, that's actually a nice thing. And now, let's take a look at the heatsink. Ah, this is still heavy. Oh, there we have it. The heatsink in all its glory. So, let's put the box away so we can take a closer look at that. So, I've made a little cut, so now the camera is closer to the desk so we can see stuff better. And yeah, here we have the heatsink of the RTX 2080 Ti Aorus Extreme. And I'm just gonna say, this is my favorite heatsink from that generation. It looks so good. I might be able to find some pictures that I took with the cards, with the card having this heatsink still. It just looks phenomenally good, in my opinion. And yeah, I kinda actually regretted moving to a water block that I'm using right now. But, well, a heatsink, an air heatsink is, at the end of the day, just an air heatsink, and I just... Yeah, I wanted better temps for my graphics card, so I moved away from this. But that means we can take a look at it today without me having to disassemble my daily system. And yeah. So, also as comparison, kinda, we have the 980 Ti Strix. I actually was gonna use that to put it onto the box and say, yeah, this is apparently, this is about how big the card is, but I forgot, so. Yeah. Can kinda. Yeah. And, so. Our heatsink right here is the... It has this special fan setup that Gigabyte also used for the 10 series. And that is that the fan in the middle is overlapping with the two on the outside. And if you get closer to them, you can actually see that the fans have cutouts. So the small fans is thin at the outside, and then the outer fans also. But these are kind... These are not as easy to see. And yeah, so the end effect of that is that you get three 100 millimeter fan, whereas other vendors like the Strix, I think these are 80 millimeters. So yeah, you get bigger fans on in the same area. The problem is though that the third fan is not really doing anything because the blades are, yeah. It's not really all that effective. So It is a quite a nice concept. I'm sure it performs better than without the middle fan, but it's not really comparable to, say, the For the Win 3 card, which has an even bigger heatsink with three full fans, and not like this one. So yeah, it is still a free slot though, so you can see those are free slots in comparison. You have the Strix right here. You can see that is a lot thinner because the Strix is a dual slot. And the 2080 Ti is putting out a lot of heat, and so yeah, it really does need this giant fin stack, and yeah, and I just wanted to make this video to appreciate this heatsink. It's I think it looks really good, and I mean, if you're not really after the highest performance, you can totally use this. It's just that I wanted to get the best overclock out of my card, and also it got a bit too hot for my liking, so I used the Darkbase 700 when I had this heatsink, and the Darkbase 700 is not really the best for airflow, and the card was getting kind of hot. It was getting over 75 degrees, at which point the clocks also pretty, yeah, it throttled pretty hard. And I just wanted it cooler, so I switched to a water block. And then later I switched to a Fractal Design Meshify S2. That one has a lot of airflow, and there this heatsink probably would have been a lot better. But like at this point, why move back to an air cooler if you have a water block? And ever since, this heatsink just kind of sat around in that box. And yeah. So we had to make a cut right there. So yeah, where was I? So yeah, switching to the new case, this would have probably improved the temperatures, but yeah, I just would rather keep the water block. And yeah, since then the heatsink has just been sitting in the box, and I haven't really done anything with it. What I'm gonna do is this is get rid of the back plate so I can show the actual heatsink a little bit. And yeah, I mean, that's pretty much everything I wanted to show in this video. It's just a look at the heatsink, at what they use to cool a 2080 Ti. And I mean, it performs better than the Founders Edition heatsink, which, yeah, it's not that hard. But the performance also wasn't stellar, so if you really want the highest overclock out of your card, which in my case, my card has a very, very unlucky core, so my core boosts really badly. So badly, in fact, that my overclocking is not limited by power limit, but by the silicon quality of the core. Which is pretty unusual because normally with 20 series cards, the problem you run into is, oh man, I forgot a screw, that's why. Normally the problem you run into with 20 series cards is power limit. For my card, it's not. My card is not only comes with one of the higher power limits, but also, yeah, is just not that great. And yeah. So while I was talking, we've got the back plate off, and we can see that Gigabyte really, really likes their thermal pads. This is a thing that I like to see, even though cooling the capacitors and the inductors might have been a little bit unnecessary. But I do like to see thermal pads for the VRM on both sides. And also thermal pads for the output capacitors, because these can actually get quite hot, where sandwiched between the GPU memory and MOSFETs. And then the, yeah, okay, these capacitors right here. I mean, if you're at it, you can just throw a thermal pad on there too. I don't really think it is necessary though. And then, yeah, we get thermal pads for memory, and then direct heat pipe That should be seven, yeah, seven heat pipes directly contacting the core. And you can still see the stock thermal paste that's left on there. The thermal paste was actually pretty decent, I guess. Like the thermal paste job looks solid. And yeah, you can also see how big the TO-102 die is. Like you can kind of see on the back of the Strix. So whatever's inside that red thing is basically the entire substrate with the core, I think. Whereas on the 2080 Ti, the die itself is as big as that. So yeah, I mean the 2080 Ti is a freakishly big core. I mean it looks absolutely amazing. I have actually recorded me assembling the card, disassembling it first, and then putting the water block on. I actually have a recording of that. I have lost it though. It is really, really old. The quality is not that good. I haven't even used my Rode microphone. I used the one off the camera because, well, my system was in pieces. Yeah. If I find the recording, I might dub it though. So, like, I show the footage and then talk over it. I'm just gonna wait until I do water cooling maintenance on my rig, and then if I just have to drain the loop anyway, I might as well just take the card out and show the PCB. Because I do want to put Cryonaut on it, the block came with Hydronaut, which kinda is the same, just optimized for water cooling, but I just want the highest performance. Like, even though, yeah, water cooling optimized, whatever, I know like Cryonaut is the best performing thermal paste that I have. And since my card is so silicon quality limited, and therefore also very, very, yeah, very bad when it comes to heat, like it only needs a couple degrees, and it will, yeah, so it's like at the point it can drive a higher overclock 5 degrees lower than normally or something. So yeah, lowering the temps further actually helps the card quite a lot. It runs faster in winter, like, and not just a bit, like almost 50 megahertz. So yeah, well, when I do water cooling maintenance, I just make sure to pull the card out and show the PCB of it, because, well, we only got the cooler now, and I really don't want to drain the system unless I have to. But I mean, let's get back to the cooler. And sorry, moving the mic a bit. So not only do we have all those thermal pads on the fin stack, we also have memory thermal pads on the back plate, which I also quite like. Maybe they could have used some more thermal pads on the back of the core and then the VRM. Like, yeah, the core thermal pad might have done something. The VRM. Yeah, that's just overcompensating. Basically, the VRM really doesn't need a heatsink. That's pretty much not an issue. Yeah, but I do like to see these thermal pads right here, and the backplate really, really got hot. It got hot. It was used to dissipate heat, and I like to see that. And then, well, my voice is actually not good today. One other thing that I like to address is it happened with this card too, and that is that the fans have non-standardized connectors. You see that right here. That's not a standard 4-pin PWM, and those two are the LEDs for the AOS logo and then the fan stop thingy. So those are not fans. And then, yeah, so these two plugs are the fans, and the thing I don't like about them is they are not standardized. And yeah, I don't like to see that, because that means the connectors on the card are also non-standardized. So if you ever want to put a different heatsink on the card and then power the fans off the card, you can't do that because you have this proprietary connector. And also, it's gonna be more difficult to find replacement fans for these, which on this card is not really that big of a deal, and I also don't think it's that much of a problem on this card. because I can understand why they would use the proprietary connectors, which is because of all those LEDs in the fans. Like, those are very obviously custom-made fans. These are not a volume production, and you have to incorporate the LEDs somehow. So I can understand that they use a connector that integrates both fan power and the LEDs for this. What I will not tolerate, though, is what ASUS is doing. Because ASUS is doing their is using their completely normal standard fans. You see these fans a lot. For example, my RX 70 has them too. And these are volume products. These are standard fans. They have not any kind of custom RGB implementation. You can see there are four standard cables coming off of them. And having a proprietary connector on this is just why. Basically, the only thing you can do is run the stock cooler or water cool it, because you can't power fans off it. And that's, yeah, that annoys me a lot. So I do have some understanding for it on this card, because it's this custom RGB stuff. I still don't really like it, because, well, the PCB is also different, but, well, I'm actually, yeah, the PCB layout is different, but, like, just imagine, just pretend that this would fit Founders Edition 2080 Ti, you would not be able to use the fans. Though the completely Founders Edition 2080 Ti also has a proprietary fan connector, but like a reference PCB that came with like a blower heatsink, and you want to switch it out for, say, this heatsink, so pretending it would fit, you would not be able to do that. And yeah, yes, this heatsink doesn't fit, but if you use this connector on one thing, you might as well use it on something else, and then you can end up with a Founders Edition heatsink that only fits one specific card. And yeah, I just don't like seeing that. But then again, I think this cooler is not really, it's not really a big of a problem that this cooler has these connectors, because, well, it's very, very custom. One other thing that, by the way, I want to highlight is, you see that there is a cutout in the cooler where the plastic kind of goes away. That's where the NVLink connector is. And so this is there to make space for a NVLink bridge. And that's actually a pretty clever design, as I think, because MSI had the same problem. They had their Gaming X Trio graphics card, where they wanted to make space for the NVLink connector. You might be familiar with what MSI did, because they did a very, very ugly looking thing, where they had two big fans and then one small one, so they can fit that NVLink cutout. So there's a part of the shroud that you can remove, and it's just like, you could have just done this. It doesn't even look bad. It looks really good, I think. Even with the GeForce RTX logo right there. Like, this is how you do it. And not like MSI. And that's basically the last thing I wanted to say. Wow, this video actually turned out rather long for just looking at a heatsink. Yeah, I mean, once I do water cooling maintenance, I will show the interesting part, which is the card. But for now, it's the heatsink. So, yeah, I guess people who consider buying cards with this heatsink can get a closer look right here. And yeah, like, this is how it looks. It's a beefy triple slot FinStack. And actually, I haven't talked about how noise is. This heatsink is very silent. I was actually surprised with how silent this is. This legitimately, like, you could almost not hear it when it was at 100%. And I think that's a good thing. Like, these are big fans. They run really smooth. And like, yeah, you don't have to spin them that fast. And also, these feel like very, very high quality fans, which, well, they are probably. And yeah. So that's kind of the last thing. And this card is actually very silent. Like, I was not expecting this to be this silent. Yeah. So, but that's like, that's really the end of the video. And yeah, I'll be reassembling this then, putting it back into the box. And yeah, so I guess thank you for watching. Hope you enjoyed. Until we see each other next time. Goodbye.